No reprieve for motorists passing EDSA just yet, as another flyover is set to undergo retrofitting activities next week. Johnson Manabat has this story.
The Department of Public Works and Highways is set to start retrofitting the Magallanes flyover along EDSA next week. Engineer Brian Briones, chief of the planning section of DPWH's National Capital Region, told ABS-CBN News the agency already secured a permit from the Metropolitan Manila Development Authority to start the rehabilitation of the flyover.
Next week, mag-start na rin kami sa Magallanes flyover. So, i-close namin yung every 100 meters, although passable pa naman siya ng mga ng vehicle. So siguro yung mga half lane yung isasarado namin.
Briones said, DPWH has a 100 million peso budget from the 2024 General Appropriations Act for the Magallanes flyover repair. MMDA Acting Chairman Attorney Romando Artes said, the road work is expected to have a minimal effect on traffic flow in the area.
Wala namang pagsasara na gagawin ng kalsada sa pagkumpuni nitong Magallanes flyover. Meron naman po yung mga traffic marshals na ina-assign ng contractor at ina-assist ng MMDA para for safety and traffic management purpose.
On Thursday, DPWH and MMDA reopened the EDSA Kamuning flyover in Quezon City 2 months ahead of the target completion date.
Tapos na po ang paglalagay ng mga carbon fiber sheet. Ngayon po ilalagay natin yung chain type na restrainers para po masigurado na during malakas na earthquake po ay hindi hihiwala yung substructure sa superstructure po nitong tulay na ito.
Ang bridge po na ito ay ni-repair para po sa paghahanda sa big one para ma-reinforce siya at maayos at makaiwas po tayo sa aksidente.
Aside from the Magallanes flyover rehabilitation project, the DPWH NCR is scheduled to retrofit other flyover and bridges in NCR. This include Delpan Bridge in Tondo and Quezon Bridge in Quiapo, both located in the city of Manila. Briones said, for the Delpan Bridge, DPWH was able to request from the national government a 60 million peso budget, while the Quezon Bridge rehabilitation will cost 155 million pesos. In Quezon City, the ongoing rehabilitation of the EDSA Quezon Avenue flyover, both northbound and southbound lanes, are about 70 to 80% complete. Each lane of the said flyover cost 151 million pesos. Johnson Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
After 5 straight weeks of price cuts, fuel products are headed higher. The Department of Energy estimates gasoline will see an increase of anywhere between 65 and 90 centavos per liter, while diesel and kerosene may see a bigger jump of anywhere between 95 centavos to 1 peso and 10 centavos per liter. It attributes the uptick to persistent tensions in oil-rich Middle East and OPEC having just trimmed its demand outlook, citing softness in China. More inflationary pressure, the Energy Regulatory Commission has granted approval for Medalco to implement adjusted rates from its suppliers' gas plants starting October. This is to allow First Gas Power Corporation, FGG Corporation, to recover the difference between the previously approved pass-through costs and the landed cost of liquefied natural gas and the new gas sale purchase agreement. The adjustments will be collected over 12 months, and the increase is estimated at 32 to 33 centavos per kilowatt hour for the October billing period. The National Economic and Development Authority drew flak from groups questioning its food poverty threshold, which claims that Filipinos who spend 64 pesos per day for their 3 meals are no longer considered food poor. Jackie Pascual has this report.
Various groups denounced the statement of the National Economic and Development Authority on the 64 pesos per person per day food budget. NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan said a person with higher budget than 64 pesos is no longer considered food poor. Amihan, a group of peasant workers, argued that with inflation still elevated, NEDA's food budget is too low, translating to just 320 pesos a day for a family of five.
As of 2023, the monthly food threshold for a family of five is 9,581 pesos. That's a comes out to about 64 pesos per person.
Ang pagtataka kasabi nga natin saan lupalop nila nakuha yung datos. Sa isang pamilya na may limang membro ay kailangan talaga niya ng 570 to 580 pesos per day para makakain ng tatlong beses isang araw.
Estavillo adds, 64 pesos equates to just 21 pesos per meal per person, which is not enough to have a decent and nutritious meal. The National Nutrition Council agrees.
Yung 64 pesos na yun ay napakaliit, wala talaga sa hugot, hindi lapat sa lupa yung datos na yun kasi simpleng yung bigas na 60 pesos per kilo.
Sabihin natin 64 pesos lang. Energy sufficient diet lang po yung makukuha natin doon. Wala masyadong sustansya.
The Philippine Statistics Authority admits the amount may be insufficient to some, but asserts its data is correct.
This methodology has been consistent since 2003. Ang idea dito ay para makita natin ano ba yung progress that we're making as a nation in terms of reducing the number of families and individuals from that threshold.
According to the PSA, the threshold sample menu includes scrambled egg, coffee, and rice for breakfast, mungo beans with malunggay, dried fish, banana, and rice for lunch, and fish or pork, vegetables, and rice for dinner. The number of food poor in 2023 also went down to 4.84 million from 6.49 million in 2021.
Mas tumaas ang kita, mas mabilis ang pagtaas ng kita doon sa mga pamilya na nasa bottom decile.
Both the PSA and NEDA plan to review the poverty threshold for next year to reflect the real situation on the ground. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Still on poverty, the number of poor Filipinos fell to 17.54 million last year from the nearly 20 million in 2021. The Statistics Authority attributed the drop to rising wages and rising employment rate due to a growing economy. To be considered poor, one must be below the country's poverty threshold. For 2023, the average poverty threshold was 13,873 pesos per month for a family of five. This means families who spend above the amount are not considered poor. The Philippine Agriculture Department eyes allowing private sector operators or cooperatives to franchise the government's so-called Kadiwa stores. The move aims to expand the operations of these state-subsidized mini-markets that sell commodities at lower prices. Agriculture Secretary Francisco Tio Laurel adds the DA is also looking to establishing more Kadiwa outlets by partnering with local government units. Currently, there are only 17 Kadiwa sites with regular operations and about 230 temporary sites. The Banco Central ng Pilipinas cut interest rates for the first time in almost 4 years ahead of the U.S. Federal Reserve, and with risks now tilted to the downside for inflation, it signaled more to come. This as policymakers look to keep the economic momentum chugging along. Lady Vicentia tells us more.
The Banco Central ng Pilipinas announced a 25 basis point cut in the country's target reverse repurchase rate during its monetary policy meeting on Thursday. This marks the first adjustment since the off-cycle hike in October 2023 and the first rate cut since November 2020. BSP Governor Eli Remolona Jr. explained balance of risks to the inflation outlook continue to lean towards the downside, despite headline inflation breaching the government's upper end of the target at 4.4% in July. Downside risks were linked to lower import tariffs on rice, while upside risks include higher electricity rates and external factors.
If you remove the base effects, you get down to 4.1, so it still breaches the target range. But 4.1 and 4.4, including the base effects, were entirely expected by our calculations. It wasn't a surprise. And in the same manner, we expect the inflation rate to be well within the target range for the August number and September number. So we think we are still justified reducing the target, the policy rate.
With the economy growing by 6.3% in the second quarter of 2024, the Monetary Board sees domestic demand to remain firm. Remolona added that the slowdown in private consumption during the second quarter was among the factors considered in their decision.
That's the reason for the easing. We're somewhat more confident in the inflation numbers coming down than in the GDP numbers going up. The main factor behind the 6.3% GDP number in Q2 was construction was the strongest, and then public spending was also strong. Consumption was relatively weak. So it doesn't look like something that could easily be sustained, and so that we went for a cut.
Remolona adds there are currently no potential risks in the near term that could derail monetary policy easing, aside from geopolitical tensions stemming from the Middle East or South China Sea. He also hinted of another rate cut in October or December. The central bank also tweaked its risk-adjusted inflation forecast for 2024 to 3.3%, up from the previous 3.1% in June, and 2.9% from 3.1% for 2025. Risk-adjusted inflation forecast for 2026 was at 3.3%. Remolona added that reducing the reserve requirement ratio for banks is up for a review.
I think we should reduce the reserve requirement quite substantially. Right now it's at a ridiculous level. It's 9.5%. It needs to go down substantially. But we haven't made any decision of when to do it. We will do it.
Lady Vicentio, ABS-CBN News.
Long weekend alert. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. moves the observance of Ninoy Aquino Day, originally on August 21st, that is next Wednesday, to August 23, a Friday. Malacanil says the move aims to promote domestic tourism by providing Filipinos with a longer weekend. National Heroes Day, meanwhile, will be observed on Monday, August 26. Ninoy Aquino Day commemorates the death anniversary of the late Senator Benigno Aquino Jr.